Pretty compelling footage there. You saw what can happen when you take an impact driver to a consumer unit.
Are you a one digger or two digger, Gary?
I think the main switch is three diggers, and I think the overcurrent protection devices are just a couple of diggers.
Yeah, well, we'll see how many diggers we need to sort of cause the damage you've just seen. But the manufacturers of circuit breakers and consumers asked us to take a look at this topic because they get lots of equipment returned that they suspect has been over-tightened using an impact driver, and obviously people just put it in the box, send it back to the wholesaler, ends up back on the desk of somebody, and then obviously, yeah, what happens from there. So we're going to look at some of the common issues that causes.
Yeah, so I think your best case scenario is you've gone in with your impact driver and actually you've stopped duggering, okay, and all of a sudden you hear that spinning sound because actually all you've done is ruin the head on the screw that you're trying to tighten up.
Yeah, and I'm getting pretty good actually. I think actually my finger is getting calibrated, so I can almost stop that happening now, and I've destroyed a lot of equipment that we're going to look at closer to do that. But yeah, I am getting better.
So your calibrated finger then, so I know that this impact driver down here goes from 0 to 155 newton meters of torque. And you think you've calibrated your finger to know how far to pull it, maybe to get to 3 newton meters.
I'm getting there, but you've sort of seen what happens. That, yeah, you saw the screw head, it's easy to, you sort of slip the bit a bit and it damages the head. And then you've seen the catastrophic failure when you slip with your trigger finger and you rip the terminal out of the MCB. And ironically, Gary, this is 155 newton meters.
Okay, yeah, this here, yeah.
If you Google AFDD, a Wylex AFDD, you'll find them on sale in CEF for £155.
Okay, so a pound per newton meter, I would suggest we're putting into that. Now that's okay, because we can see the clear damage, can't we, of the completely destroyed device, and maybe the head of the screw is not really going to cause as much problem when we've left it. But it's the hidden damage, isn't it? It's what's going on inside the device that's the problem that's going to actually be sometime in the future, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it. You easily see the catastrophic damage. Yeah. It's that in-between land that we've found, and I've got a few examples of that here.
Okay, in this sort of wilderness of destroyed bits and bobs, yes? Yeah.
So let's look at this RCBO here that I've previously had a go at with the impact driver. A couple of duggers into this. So the terminal, the bus bar, is pretty solidly lodged in there. I can waggle it, but it's not coming out. And in fact, it's probably never coming out, actually, because this screw, I can just tighten it now.
For all eternity.
And it just keeps, yeah. That's that's no way that's ever coming out again.
So what's happened to the thread on that one, then?
So I've probably stripped the threads in there, and that happens a lot. That's, and you can even do that with a manual screwdriver.
Right.
If you just, you know, if you're one of those people who uses two hands to get the tension up there, you just get to a point where you strip the threads out.
And again, that comes back to why the manufacturers set a torque setting for their terminals, because they know the limits of those screws, don't they?
Yeah, it is. It's about getting that torque setting for a great electrical connection. If you go beyond it, obviously you can strip the screw heads, or if it gets further, obviously inside these devices, there's obviously more and more becoming more sensitive electronics. So if we start with the Lewden one we've seen there.
So what we've got, an RCBO, were we going to show me?
Yeah, so here's another one I destroyed earlier.
Okay, so straight away I noticed that that's a little bit more involved than the standard circuit breaker, because we've got a PCB board there in the corner, haven't we?
Yeah, and you look, connections to this PCB through these two fine wires that are immediately behind the terminal. So if you look at the example where it's completely twisted.
Ah, right, okay. So that stress would follow itself down through into there.
Yeah, and that's happening more and more. And you know, you sort of get we see a lot of comments from the old timer electricians who've been at it for years, and they've always just done things by feel. We didn't have torque screwdrivers, but let's remember, circuit breakers used to look like this classic C50 from one of Gary's from his apprenticeship when he was installing these.
And there's not a lot going on in there, is there? You know, I mean, we've probably got some substantial terminals top and bottom, which I'd like to have a look at. So they are substantial, aren't they? So proper large connections there, whether we were on the bus bar or the conductors.
Yeah.
And obviously it's physically quite a large device compared to what the modern ones look like, isn't it?
Yeah, and different types of terminal. So now everyone, obviously these cage clamp terminals are popular. These ones, you'd have to double the wire over and twist it round and all sorts of things. But there's a lot of copper in there. The only things in there be the bimetallic strip,
yes,
for the slow overload protection, and the solenoid and the arc chute for the for the instantaneous.
And some substantial copper maybe connecting them all together, but we know obviously now they're looking way more delicate, and obviously they're getting smaller and smaller, and we're suggesting that the hidden damage is the one maybe that's onto the PCB board or those very fine connections. But it takes an up another level when you start thinking about arc fault detection devices, doesn't it?
Yeah, so we've gone through a process of miniaturization.
Yes.
Yeah, so people didn't like, RCBOs when there were two modules wide. At first we went, sort of longer and we got them into one module. But I mean, I must say that Wylex have done a fantastic job on their single module AFDD.
Yeah, you've done a fantastic job on it as well, by the looks of things.
It's built like a Swiss watch.
Okay.
Literally like a Swiss watch. There is a lot of very small components in there and quite sensitive components.
Okay.
But, they do have torque settings. So if we look at the side of the device.
Okay, I don't like it on the side. I'll come to that in a minute. So show me where it is on the side.
Yeah, so we've got a torque setting for the incoming terminal on the bus bar, 3 Newton meters.
Okay, yeah.
And another setting for the outgoing terminals, 2 Newton meters, and to specify the screw head type that you should use for it, which is good. So why don't you light them on the side, Gary?
Because once I've installed them, obviously, and I've come back, maybe I'm working on them, I can't see them on the side. I do like them when they're on the front, and the Lewden ones in front of us here, I've got it clearly on the front. So obviously by this screw head that I'm going in at, I can clearly see the Newton meters of torque. So do you want to bring one of those in for me? So let's have a little look. So let's show, yeah, so that is 2.5 Newton meters for where it goes onto the bus bar, isn't it? Have we got any more on there?
On that, we've got the same, I mean, it's the same on the switch, top and bottom.
Yeah, okay, so in two positions though, clearly by the side of the terminals, where you're going to make those connections.
Yeah, I mean, that, we think that is best practice.
Yeah, that's the future.
But that Wylex one, still 2 Newton meters is quite generous on the terminals for that AFDD.
Yeah.
We've seen some of the new ones come to the market now where you're down at 1.2 Newton meters.
Yeah, and that takes us back to when we tried to prove whether or not an electrician's arm is calibrated. And if you haven't checked out that video, I'm sure we'll leave it in the eye above your head and obviously in the description. But we had this one here at 0.8 Newton meters of torque, didn't we? Mm. And it was incredible how little effort you put in, and 1.2 is not much more, is it?
No, it's not. So that's a great reason to have a torque screwdriver. That's one thing, but think of the other, think of that financial reason. People aren't really bothered, manufacturers, well, they probably are actually, but in the grand scheme of things, an MCB, what we're at, just over £2?
Two to a fiver, let's go there, yes, okay. RCBOs, we're probably going from £9 to £25 maybe in that region.
Yeah.
AFDDs, probably £146.98 to £146.97.
Or £155 if you're at your CF.
That's super expensive.
If you've got a consumer unit full of those and you're working under development, as we saw when we were down at Park Erin,
yes,
where all of the houses had AFDDs in, if you were using the impact driver across there and you start having problems, both now or in the future, a little bit down the road, the manufacturer is more likely to investigate.
Yeah, and I think that'll be turn up on site, won't it? Look at your practice.
Absolutely.
And if you've got failure after failure after failure, they're going to obviously first of all look at what you're doing before they suggest they've got a product failure, aren't they?
Yeah, so, and it's just general thing we see more in electrical installations. There's more electronics coming in,
yeah,
which means there tends to be more products with PCB boards in there.
Yeah.
We see it all the way through from EV chargers, where there's a lot of electronics in there. You're taking quite a big chunky cable on there. If you, I've never seen anyone use an impact driver on those terminals yet, but you could probably guarantee it would just wrench it straight off the PCB. But let's not forget, in these AFDDs, there are some tiny PCBs in them. I mean, it's worth having a look at this, Gary.
Yeah, this is, we have destroyed. You love this, don't you? Yeah.
Yeah, this is the PCB that's inside an AFDD, or that's inside the Wylex one there. So we've got our digital signal processor, flexible circuit boards between it, up to the little test switch, there's the little LEDs there, okay, to for the glow on the indicator. Yeah, there's a lot of...
That looks like technology you expect to see in a latest iPhone for me. Now, getting it super tight doesn't make it a better electrical connection, and I don't believe that using an impact driver inside a consumer unit, maybe if you're doing new builds and you're up against time, actually is really going to save you any real time, is it?
No. I mean, it's as I said, there's lots of reasons why you should be using a torque driver, following those manufacturer's instructions.
Absolutely.
If you're ignoring that, then yeah, you are you're obviously putting the installation at risk, but you're also putting yourself at a financial risk because this equipment now we're installing is going up in price.
But as always, we're interested in your feedback. Is this practice you've seen and witnessed on site and you've got some great stories you want to tell the community? Please leave those comments below. You've perhaps watched the videos in this series and actually you can see why the torque screwdriver should be used in the locations where they're specifying the torque setting. And that includes things like the front of EV chargers, doesn't it, with the gasket seal, etc., in order that you can obviously have that warranty maintained from the manufacturer. We'd be interested in all those comments if you leave them below. Me and Gordon, we will try and get back to as many as we can, but we've got a new ending, haven't we?
We have. And just remember, there's no such thing as a calibrated arm.
There isn't.